People are charmed about better humanity. Then the public officials in the dock, in their state capacities, are not the proper person to render account to the law and the public. It is the SST as an entity that should do so. And this would entail not just the first accused, but the three cabinet ministers who managed it as trustees, perhaps alongside some members of this society. What, in my view, this trial has revealed is a startling and near complete falsity of regulation in the functions and operations of the SST, a body vested in a crucial public mandate, but whose operations have by design or negligent omission, remained open to the public. Finally, as I observed earlier, the design of the charges is suggestive of an orchestration of the process of allocation of the subject land by the first accused through his junior, the second accused, and perhaps other officials in the then ministry. The evidence of his juniors in the ministry does not support such a scenario. Indeed, the evidence that the first accused did not make any communication to them during the processes they undertook. In their submission, the first counsel violated two significant matters, namely the relative modest shareholding of the first accused in Midlands, and the fact that Midlands was in fact a public company with 14 entities in commerce. These circumstances do not appear to me to provide sufficient incentive to the first accused to justify the misadventure of this kind of suggestion. Even if it were to be supposed for a moment that he was at the helm of a nefarious scheme to grab the state land, it would ultimately be to the benefit of 14 entities shareholders, some holding vastly higher amounts of shares than the had. In the end, this would benefit more from the effort than the perpetrator that would make serious sense. I also think the participation in the scheme of the highest local and national leadership and its very public high-level launch are matters that ought to have received greater consideration by the investigators that they appear to have done. In discounting the well-developed theory that it was a fraudulent scheme intended to benefit a few people. Determination. The conclusions I've reached hearing above mean that the allegation in the bulk of the charges to the effect of the septic land and indeed its mother title, Clause 530, were unavailable for alienation is fully accounted. It also means that only the SFT could be made accountable criminally or otherwise to anything done or omitted in the process of transfer of title to the septic land. When no evidence is told that ascribes any misdeed or impropriety on the SFT or any of its officials as such, then it cannot be said that there was any improper confinement of the subject land as a benefit to Midland, or even an abuse of office. Similarly, it would not be said that the disposal and or acquisition of the subject land was fraudulent. Finally, as relates to the first accused, merely proving that he was the sitting minister for land and housing, and that he was also a director of Midland's gold mall, was insufficient basis for the unstated conclusion apparent in the design of the charges that he had state managed the allocation of the subject land to Midland. I therefore determine and find as relates to the charges as follows. 1. Enough is already said to show that the charges in counts 1, 3, 4, 6, and 7 cannot stand, and that's the dismissal which I hereby order for. 2. The charge of failure to disclose a private interest in count 2 against the first accused is barred in law for failing to disclose the offense and usage in section 42, subsection 1, paragraph A, as said in section 42, paragraph subsection 1, paragraph B, in that non-disclosure by itself does not constitute the offense intended, and no evidence is against to support the charge in any way. Moreover, from the facts placed on record, the entity to whom the first accused would require to disclose his interest would have been the SFT, and no evidence available to show that he both failed to make that disclosure and participated in the decision relating to the application for allocation in the Midland to the SFT. There is also the curious scenario created by the fact that the first accused boss and appointing authority, the president of the council, was a store member and shareholder at Midlands, entitled to vote in the election of directors as such, and presumed to have been aware of the directorship of the first accused. I equally dismiss the charge in count 2 against the first accused. The charge in count 3, the charge in count 5 against the second accused, to the effect that she acted in a manner prejudicial to the public by issuing a letter of offer to Midlands, cannot stand because there is no evidence of a fault attributable to the SFT process of allocating the subject land to Midlands. Because no investigations were conducted in relation to the SFT secretariat, there is no evidence to show that the second accused could not sign letters of offer either on behalf of the SFT or on behalf of the officer administering the fund, who at the time was her boss, the PS in the Ministry of Land. Her actions are further vindicated by her colleagues in the ministry, who testified that the procedure followed was valid. this count is equally dismissed. Finally, the charge against third and fourth accused of 8 must fail because no fraud is demonstrated against third and fourth accused in the process of acquisition by the fourth accused of its title to land parcel number Nandaro, Stock Jabini, Stock 5862 from the SFT. Moreover, in his capacity as director, the third accused is deemed to have acted on behalf of the entire board of directors because the contrary is not shown. If indeed there was criminality involved, then the entire board would be culpable and charging him alone would, in that case, in my view, amount to selective prosecution. Either way, the charge is already dismissed. The upshot is that no prima facie case having been established against any of the accused persons in any of their respective counts as required by law, and in terms of such impudence, I hereby acquit each one of them in each of their respective counts. As a parting shot, I must mention and condemn what I noted as recurrent attempt by both the submissions on behalf of the first accused and the state to canvass matters that are not born of the record of evidence. It is quite clear that no evidence can be introduced by those submissions, and parties are limited at that point in the arguments to the recorded evidence. That is the ruling delivered today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. On behalf of the prosecuting counsel and the defense counsels, we wish to thank you for that well considered ruling. And I think the accused have been vindicated, and on their behalf, we also wish to thank you. I think Lillian can now retire in peace because he's about to retire.
Your Honor, have we applied for a copy of the ruling?
Yes, I was going to say that in line with the times and what we have been doing, parties will simply get a scanned copy of the ruling by mail. So we will cancel should give us I believe we have the email addresses. So that all parties can still get a scanned copy of the ruling.